Good morning. I am Wanda Lynn Gavan, the attorney representing Mr. Johnny Mims on behalf of the Alabama Education Association. My name is spelled J-U-A-N-D-A-L-Y-N-N, last name G-I-V-A-N. Today we have asked you members of the media to assemble here at the Birmingham Division Office of the Alabama Education Association. Present here today is the Associate Executive Director, Mr. Theron Stokes, also the Supervising Attorney and Lead Counsel for the Alabama Education Association, and he leads that entire legal division there. Other members associated here today are members that are entitled Uniserve Directors, and they serve all corners of Jefferson County and the state of Alabama, as well as Mr. Johnny Mims, the individual in question, our client, and the person who was assaulted by the Birmingham Police Department, giving rise to these incidents. Today we are here to discuss with you the incidents that gave rise on September the 14th, 2023, after a football game between Minor High School and Jackson Olin High School here in the city of Birmingham. This incident gave rise to Mr. Mims being excessively tased with what we have termed as a stun gun or a taser in common terms. We feel that it was an assault on him physically as well as on his character. Today we are here to discuss some of the particulars of the incident that arose and as well as to give Mr. Mims an opportunity to speak to you collectively. At this time, I would ask that Anna Byrne, Uniserve Director, who is also the Uniserve Director for Mr. Mims here in the Birmingham area, if she would come forth on behalf of the Alabama Education Association.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Anna Byrne. I am one of the Uniserve Directors for District 28, which includes Jefferson County. I'm thrilled to be able to represent my member. This is what we do at AEA. We stand behind our members. And I could not be happier that he has the best legal team around to represent him. This was an unfortunate event for our community, for our schools, for our parents, and for our students. And so I have all the confidence in the legal team moving forward, and we will continue to advocate for our members. Thank you.
Thank you. At this time, we are asking, you will formally now hear from Mr. Mims.
Good morning. Again, my name is Johnny Mims, J-O-H-N-N-Y-M-I-M-S. I'm the director in question. First of all, I'd like to thank you guys for being here today, for giving me the opportunity as an educator to give my side of the story. On Thursday, September 14th, we were preparing for just a normal day. A normal football game is what we normally do. We prepare 3 days a week for our football games. I was traveling over to Jackson Olin High School with a group of about 145 students with chaperones and with staff. We were preparing for the game as we would normally do. We came in and played. The band sounded amazing as is expected from our stellar students. And then towards the end of the game, the director from Jackson Olin High School came over to set up a coordination of playing a few tunes after the game, which we agreed upon we'd do 2 to 3 tunes, and then we established that we would do 3 tunes at that point. And so we followed suit. And so it brings all into question of what happened in this situation, which should never have happened to me or to the students or to the parents to have to even see. And again, most important thing I want everybody to know that I was just doing my job. As an educator, instructing the band, allowing the band to play, and again, just celebrating the achievements of our football team, cheerleader squad, and our band program. The things that happened in that game should have never happened. The students should have never seen me tase. Those things should have never happened. I was not trying to be defiant to the police department. Again, I was just trying to do my job, which was previously established before the end of the game. And so I think it's important for everybody to know that it was coordinated. It's something that is customary to bands. And again, we want to make sure that everybody doesn't lose sight of that the students were caught in this. It's very important to understand also that the lights were cut off towards the end of that. It was performing those tunes, and so that further made it more difficult for us to be able to move the students out of the stadium in an orderly fashion way, because more importantly, we have to always be careful to make sure that we consider the students and make sure that they're safe entering and out of a stadium. And so that's the account of what happened at the game. It's very unfortunate. I should have never been tased. It was excessive. And I think that should have, no educator should ever have to experience that. But I definitely don't want us to ever lose sight of the students who were caught in the middle of this. They are the most important thing in this situation. Thank you.
One thing I want to add on behalf of Mr. Mims is that it was alleged that he struck a Birmingham police officer. I know many of you in the media have received some video footage, body cam footage from them, and I want to make sure that I reiterate something, that is not the only footage. There were several pieces of body cam that the City of Birmingham Police Department is in control and in they are the custodians of. I am now in possession of that video footage, and they failed to give all versions of the body cam information to you all. And again, once you receive that information, we've started circulating, you will see that my client never struck or attempted to strike a Birmingham police officer. At this time, we have Daryl Sinkfield, Assistant Executive Director of Field Services, on behalf of the Alabama Education Association.
Again, a protocol has been established. We welcome the media here today, but we want everybody to know that the Alabama Education Association stand by our members. As been stated, this was a very unfortunate situation that happened to Mr. Mims, our students, this community. And we as members of the Alabama Education Association want our members here far and near to understand that when things happen, AA would be there to come to their rescue and come and stand by their side. Mr. Mims is a very important member of the association. He's been in this district for 6 years, been an excellent band director, and we just want him to know today we stand ready to make sure that his due process is not violated and that he will seek and be able to go back into this school and provide those great services that he's been providing. So Mr. Mim, we stand beside you as the members of AEA. Thank you.
At this time, we will hear from the Associate Executive Director and Head Lead Attorney for the Alabama Education Association, Darren Stokes.
Good morning. What I like to say is that we appreciate everyone for coming, but this is what's important about this situation. This should be a learning situation for not only the folks that was involved in what happened at the football game, but also it should be for all other school districts and everywhere to learn the importance of how you treat band directors, how you treat students when you're at a game. One of the things we learned now over the years is that we cannot allow violence to be the way we handle situations. In this situation, violence was not needed. Matter of fact, it was not necessary. What we feel like, it should have been an example of how not, this is an example of how not to do things in the school system. Well, it's a football game, and remember now that the folks who were attending the football game, a lot of them were students. The band had 145 members. Those same students take classes in school regarding government, law enforcement, how to respect law enforcement. They are trained and taught that way. However, law enforcement must set an example as to how they treat students, citizens of this state, because it's unfortunate that a minor incident like this turned into such a tragic situation. And I said tragic in the sense that the impression that those students received from this situation will be life with them for life. They will always remember. And one of the biggest problems we have is getting the public to trust and respect law enforcement. That's one of the biggest problems we have. And it's so unfortunate to see that over the years where minor traffic incidents or minor situation in the public turn into not only a serious situation, but tragic situations. So we would like to be able to work with law enforcement. We appreciate the Birmingham City Police Department. We respect them. But on the same token, their officers must operate in an efficient and safe manner. If it's with their intent to protect the patrons and the students that were at the football game, why would they turn off the lights when they were still in there? Why would you allow persons to be trying to exit a stadium in the dark? That is just not justifiable in this situation. What we see here and what they did to Mr. Mims, the first time they said he tased him and it had no effect on him. I'm wanting to know, y'all. Y'all see Mr. Mims, he's not a very big guy. And you tased him once. Then you tased him again. Then you tased him again. I just think that was something that was totally unnecessary. So what we feel is that the schools have a right to protect all of its persons that are attending games at the school, at football game. As you know, the fifth quarter situation is traditional where they play songs at the end of the game. They play the school alma mater, and both bands would play. This was something that was routine. I guarantee you, Mr. Johnny Mims did not wake up last Thursday to say he was going to a football game to be treated like a criminal. That was not his intent. So what we are saying is, let's have some accountability. Right now, Mr. Mims has been placed on administrative leave by his school district, as if though he was wrong. He was wrong. I have not heard anything saying what is going to be done to the officers that was involved in this situation. Yes, we are requesting that Mr. Mim be put back to work, because it was not his fault. Well, to say that we can have a fun time at a football game should be ordinary, should be routine. We should be able to cheer, shout, and yell for our team. If our team loses, we still need to have respect, and we still need to be professional in how we treat the other team. Because you know what? They call that sportsmanship. That's what you're supposed to be teaching children in high school. But you also need to be teaching them how to be treated by law enforcement so that they won't go around having a fear that every time they get pulled over by a policeman or they get stopped in a store by a security guard or anywhere in this country that they're going to be treated fair and with respect. So what we're here today to say that we want justice for Mr. Mims. We want him to be treated fair. We want him to be treated with respect. Also, we want the officers involved in this to be held accountable for the action. And again, I say, we know that we have some great, fine officers in the Birmingham with the Birmingham Police Department. We have some great officers in Jefferson County, all across this country. But we cannot let the few make it bad for the whole. And in this situation, it was exactly that. We had a few officers saying they were trying to protect folks by making sure folks exit the stadium when they turn off the lights. And someone could have easily just missed a step, stepping down from the stands and hurt themselves. And then you saw the chaos that pursued. If the lights were on, you could have had a better video of what took place, but the lights were off. And I have not heard anyone justify why the lights were being turned off. So what we are asking, y'all, we are open to letting you know that we represent Mr. Mims, AEA represent Mr. Mims, and we're here today on behalf of Mr. Mims.
Thank you, Mr. Stokes.
The last things that I will say is before opening it up, many of you have inquired, where are we? We have started what is called the discovery process, and that is we have submitted a notice of appearance on behalf of Mr. Mims to the Birmingham Municipal Court. We have also been in communication with the city attorneys. There was a meeting on yesterday evening between myself and several of the city attorneys, as well as Ms. Anna Byrne, who is here present with us today, to begin to review all of the body cam footage. I was actually, I did receive the body cam footage, as well as some other discoverable information. We are now going through that. I do want to express that we actually went through several different versions of the body cam, some of which I was surprised to hear that the city attorney had not even viewed yet. It was also my understanding that they did not have full knowledge of the fact that the Birmingham police was going to release in the manner that they released on Monday. The body cam for which you all are seeing, which also demonstrates to us an attempt by them to get ahead of the story with an altered version of the body cam that you all are seeing in order to put themselves in a positive light. We are going to be also sitting down with the Sheriff's Department because there were two officers, because they are minor high schoolers at a county school. There was also two sheriffs there, deputies that were also there that are resource officers. However, they did not engage in any of this these accounts that took place. But I've spoken with Sheriff Petway, and he has advised me that I can come over to view the body cam images that they have as well. He said that his deputies knew not to engage because that's not their responsibility to get involved with home rule. It is our position that it was not the city of Birmingham's position, or that it was within their authority to direct my client. That should have been addressed with either the principals of Minor High School and or Jackson Olin. And I leave you with this. The questions that need to be asked is, where were the administrators? Where were the supervisors? Where were the people who had supervision over the two band directors? And also, with regards to the fifth quarter show, the band director from Jackson Olin came over to my client. We have witness account of that to state that they were going to, in fact, have a fifth quarter activity, because I know many of you have been asking about the fifth quarter. My client just didn't initiate that on his own. And so we, again, stand firmly by our belief that this was excessive force, unnecessary and unwarranted. There were multiple Birmingham police officers there, and the size of my client, he should have been able to be subdued in some kind of manner, but it never should have escalated. It's their role to de-escalate a situation. That was a situation in which they were in, as Attorney Stokes has said, in front of 145 children who were ultimately traumatized. The situation at hand, in which they have accused my client of striking, hitting, or shoving a Birmingham police officer, is just another attempt by law enforcement, as they have done across this country, to validate their bad acts. And this is no different from the police officer in the Tyree Nichols situation that said that because he became so enraged because Tyree Nichols kicked him during an attempted traffic stop. Well, I'm glad my client was at the stadium, because the acts of this particular Birmingham, these particular Birmingham police officers could have ultimately, had no cameras been there, had they been outside the presence of third parties, if you're so enraged that you have to draw a taser and shock, and almost, that's a form of electrocution. That's what happens when you tase somebody. I could only imagine what would have happened from this particular officer had there not been cameras there and warm bodies at the facility. At this time, we will open up the floor for questions.
Hi, Lori Daniel, NBC News. Are you going to ask that those other views be released, the videos?
I am going to ask, and I'm going to release them myself. I have copies of them, and we've started a process last night of trying to get that information out.
If you could share with us, what has this experience been like for you and your family? If they've seen this video, if you're married, if you have children, if they've seen or heard about it, what has this been like for you guys?
It's very difficult even talking about, because as you can hear in the videos, you can hear screams from the students and the parents. I know my students very well. I know the community that I work for. I can just feel emotions, just again seeing the parents here supporting me. It's very emotional, because it's something we all agree, everybody agree, this is something that should never have happened. And so to know that those students seen that happen, to know that they seen that happen to somebody they respect and love, we are a team. We call it the SOS family. We're very tight. It's heartbreaking. It's traumatizing. It's difficult. I get a question a lot, like, how are you doing? There's no way to explain how I'm doing, because I know that my students are hurting. I know that they come to school every single day trying to figure out when their director is going to be back. When, because I'm always there in the morning to welcome them, to say good morning, how are you doing? Like, we have that type of bond. So regardless of what was going on in that stadium, regardless of the questioning or we need to leave, none of that's more important than the interaction that happens on a day-to-day basis between me and the students and the staff that inspire those students. And so this is a very hard, difficult thing to get past. But I just dread this situation in a way that it will be something that the kids have to deal with on a day-to-day basis. Well, that's the special thing about the Minor High School Band, one of the best band programs in the country, is that we built a leadership team within that group, where we have student leaders, we have a great parent booster program, so all parts of the band that has already been intacted work together to make everything happen, because it was always said that regardless of what happens to any individual within a group, the band still has a responsibility, and so their responsibility is to get ready for the next performance. And so I'm so proud of them. I of course can't be there, but I know people can hear the music. If you go into Walmart to buy some chips, you're going to hear the Minor High School Band in there. And so that's the thing that's special. They're one of the best programs in the country, and the students, all they wanted to do is to play and enjoy an opportunity to perform at a football game for their fans who came to see them.
Valerie Bell with ABC 3340. Mr. Mims, what do you think that your actions towards police officers, what kind of example, or how did students respond to seeing them?
I think the students know deep down in their heart that Mr. Mims all would is to make sure that we were able to finish what we were doing, which had already been agreed upon. These are the things that the students look forward to and they prepare for. And so that interaction that you've seen, I know for the students, it was just like Mr. Mims was just making sure that we were able to complete what we were doing, which was playing the song. And you've seen that in the video footage, which if the lights weren't cut off, you would see a proper cutoff of that song. And I think that's how they took that situation.
And just following up to that, on the video, several times you can be heard saying, "Get out of my face," to a uniformed officer. Regardless of who is right or wrong in that situation, do you believe that that escalated the situation to what it led into, rather than just ending like Jackson Olin's band director did and taking it up with more authority at the Birmingham Police Department or school administrators?
It shouldn't. If you look in the video, you can see the officer leaning over, and so the only feedback you're getting from me was letting the officer know it because you're between me and the students. And so you're interfering. If you wanted it was important for us to cut off or for us to leave, you're interfering with the opportunity for me to do that with the students by being in front and yelling at me. So it should have never escalated because officers, we're taught, and as an educator, you're taught that people are going to say stuff to you all the time, but you still have to keep your composure. And for me, that was an opportunity for we're done with the end of the song. We get off the podium, you pull me off the side and say, hey, listen, these are the situations why we need to have you guys leave. None of that information was communicated. And you can hear in the video how the officer was approaching me. And the same thing, it's got to be a respect on both sides. And I feel like that was exactly what wasn't done.
And I want to add something to that because that question, is Valerie? Valerie, that you just asked, you need to see all of the video footage. You need to see the JO side of the field. How did they approach the JO band director? At what time and what period did the JO band director stop? Was he playing? Was he in mid-song? What was he doing at the time he was so when you're saying that they said stop, they may not have said stop to the band director while he was actually up conducting. So that's why I want you all to get copies of the video footage and see the real story as to what happened. They may not have walked up to the JO band director and used certain words that I cannot say here today and approached the JO band director in the way they approached my client. You can hear on one of the pieces of footage that the police, one of the officers are saying that they were gonna call Dr. Sullivan or the superintendent, and if not, my client would have to pay them overtime. So was it a thing that they were so ready to leave that they, because it's just a monetary issue? At the end of the day, I have much footage that will demonstrate that there's more to this story, but regardless of what happened, shy of him actually physically trying to harm a police officer, there was nothing. And there is nothing you can't show me in a code book, you can't show me anywhere in writing, because if that were the case, that anybody, if you say something back to the police, that you should be arrested, you don't see that. You don't see anything in a code book that says that you can be automatically tased or assaulted. You don't see that in a code book. If that's the case, many of you in this room today would have been apprehended at the mere fact that a police officer stopped you to ask you or to inform you that you were speeding. So that's not an excuse, and I'm gonna stop that right now. It's unacceptable for my client to be tased the way he was tased by the Birmingham Police Department. It was excessive. You're gonna see in the footage that you will see, you're gonna see A, the response from the police, officers that may not even have been on that side of the field. There's even one Birmingham police officer that was on the JO side once they were radioed and all of the ruckus started. Someone informed him that his partner had tased my client. The first thing he says, and it's clear, Anna Byrne was sitting there with me and as well as the prosecutor, oh no. He tased him. Where did a taser come from? You hear Birmingham police officers literally on there saying, oh my God, this never should have happened. You see the response and certain portions are cut off at the time that my client was pulled from the conductor stand. He was dragged down from the conductor stand by one of the security officers and a Birmingham police officer. That never should have happened. It didn't have to happen that way. All the Birmingham Police Department had to do was to allow my client, as he said, he was wrapping up, and in some of the footage you will see it, that situation could have been where he wrapped up the song and everything would have been quieted down and it would have been over and we wouldn't be here today. But to manhandle someone, to snatch him off a conductor stand, you tell me what you would have done, regardless of how it started. Because I know there are some folks standing right in this room that would have said, why are you arresting me? Is it wrong to ask someone why they're arresting you? Is it wrong to say and proclaim that you didn't do anything? At the time, and I'm speaking now only at the point of contact, at the time that he was tased, everyone in here saw the footage. My client was simply doing this. Why are you doing this? What did I do? And he asked that repeatedly. And then some police officer from the city of Birmingham, who feels that he is above reproach because he wears a badge, decided to tase him. So there was enough time between whatever happened when they initially approached my client that there should have been a warming down period, and it should have been able to de-escalate the situation. These officers obviously need training. And another thing I'll add, this wouldn't have happened in Mountain Brook. It wouldn't have happened in Hoover. It wouldn't have happened in Vestavia or Homewood. This would dare not have happened at a majority white school in the state of Alabama, that you would see a black police officer tasing anyone on those campuses. And everyone in this room knows that. It wouldn't have happened. You couldn't have paid them. I don't care if the kids never left the field. I don't care if the conductor continued to conduct all night. They would not have said one single thing. But you would dare tase a black man in a black school within a city, in the city of Birmingham, which is a majority black city, it's okay? No, ma'am. It's not okay. And that is why this story has gone viral. That is why the national media is concerned, because they've never witnessed anything like this. So the question should not be whether he could have done anything. The question is, what did the police ultimately do? That's a great question, Magdala. I literally, before coming here, spoke with Mark Sullivan, Dr. Sullivan. And Dr. Sullivan said that he was totally unaware. And he was, at this point, going to call the band director in from J.O. because he spoke to us, and he said that his band director should have known. Look at the footage. Common sense tells you, if the J.O. band was playing at some point, there had to be a mutual assent between the parties. So it didn't just happen by happenstance that my client was playing. If you just ask, someone just asked the question, if the Birmingham Police Department had stopped them, if they asked them to stop, so obviously they were in concert together at some point. So there's no way that the band director from Jackson Olin was not aware that my client would be participating in what is called the fifth quarter. He literally walked over, and we have witness account of it. He came from across the J.O. side to my client and directed my client of the fact that they would be holding a fifth quarter performance during at the close of the game. My client did not go to him. And so as a part of the camaraderie, as he mentioned, he acquiesced to that request or the comments that came from Mr. Fitzpatrick, I think it is, who is the band director of Jackson Olin.
Sydney Spencer with CBS 42. I know at the end of your press release you sent out on Monday, says you guys are seeking damages not only for pain and suffering, but also to shed light. Can you just elaborate on that?
Absolutely. This is a matter, this again, we can't repeat it enough. Attorney Stokes said it, I said it, my client has said it. This is a matter that never should have happened. We believe that there was an injustice done. We are seeking all legal, any legal actions that we think would make my client whole. My client was struck. They didn't know if he had a pacemaker. Over 1,000 plus people per year die because of after being tased. They didn't know his health condition. What would have happened? This is a small man, just as Attorney Stokes said, had they killed my client. My client has had to go to the hospital. He had to go yesterday for another checkup. They had to remove the darts or what have you out of his arm. So there are some things that we are looking into, and we will address all of those at the appropriate time. And lastly, and since we are talking about the taser, the question is, and it's interesting with you, where you all standing here, no one in this media court has asked the city of Birmingham about the taser they use. The city of Birmingham uses one of the most high-powered tasers in the country. No one in this room has asked about the cycle. How many cycles? That's good reporting. The public needs to know that.
One of the things we're going to be asking the superintendent for Jefferson County to do is to place them back to work, Mr. Mims. And we're going to be asking parents parents in the at the school, also citizens in Jefferson County, to request that Mr. Mims be placed back to work. This has gone universal. We've heard nationally, we've heard from different parts of the country asking, why did this happen? Well, we need to correct it. And the first way of correcting it is putting Mr. Mims back to work, because he was doing an excellent job at Manor. So we're asking that once this being exposed, sometimes you have to expose the bad things to correct them. So we're asking now that this be corrected. And we want and hope that the Birmingham City Police will take this as opportunity to train their officers not to, in a way, how to handle situations like this at school, in a game. Because we know it's important for everyone to feel safe when they go to a football game. And that's why they are there. They are there to make sure people are safe. So we want them to understand that we want to work with them, not against them. So Mr. Mims feels as though he has been mistreated. We can't undo what he has done. He was tased and all and pushed down on the floor and on the concrete and mistreated. But we can say going forth, it's a lesson learned, and that this should never happen again. And because the fifth quarter, whether the fifth quarter was sanctioned or not, you don't treat a band director who, and let me tell you about the band director. The band doesn't move till the band director tells it to move. So talking to Mr. Mims and get him an opportunity to move out a 145-member band, that was important, and the officers should have known that that was important. So what we are saying now, let's correct it. Let's get all on one page. So that our students will be educated the right way about how they should be treated by law enforcement, and not be a fear of worrying about if somebody pull them over or talk to them about a minor incident that they're going to be mistreated.
I just want to get one more question.
Let me do this. Let me get box six first, and then since you've asked two questions.
Just two quick questions. First and foremost, you spoke about responsibility. I know y'all want Mr. Mims to return to teaching. Do you all have any requests or anything y'all asking for PPD regarding the officers involved in the situation?
Yes, as Attorney Stokes has said, we have requested that they be placed on administrative leave, but I find it interesting, even with the Birmingham Police and the blanket statement they released, not one time do they say they regret or that they apologize to the extent that students were present to witness the accounts that took place. So we are asking that those individuals be placed on administrative leave, and we're hoping that some different actions will be taken in the next coming days, and especially as we begin to roll out the different footage of the body cam. But I think it's very unfortunate, even just a matter of as administrative caution, since there's an investigatory process, you would have at least thought that these officers should have been placed on leave instead of continuing with unfounded accusations of my client punching or shoving a Birmingham police officer.
Lastly, do we have any idea who was the entity or individual that did turn off the lights? I know in some districts it's school personnel, some maybe it is law enforcement. That definitely aided to to the problem? Do we know
I requested that information this morning from Dr. Sullivan. He told me he would get back with me sometime this afternoon, and hopefully I will have that information. I have been able to identify the two security officers. That was something I was working on this morning, and so we're waiting to hear back from Dr. Sullivan and the Birmingham City School System. What was the probable cause? Because if you're alleging that my client hit you, the way those tempers were flaring on that day, you would have known that my client had actually struck a Birmingham police officer. Again, it's the fabrication of the story that they want the media to give life and breathe life into. That is why they released the footage the way they released it, unbeknownst to the city attorney at the time, and because they were trying to get ahead of the story. The question becomes, if my client hit or shoved or punched a Birmingham police officer, should not some other crime be attached to this harassment? How was he harassing the police?
But the other thing is, we have more than one witness. Mm-hmm. We have at least 145 student witnesses this situation. So what the Birmingham City Police are saying, we respect that. But we also going to respect the eyewitnesses that were there and saw this event, this tragic event in the sense of how Mr. Mims was treated.
And some of those witnesses are in the room as we speak. And so you can hear, I'm sure some of you all will question them, and multiple witness accounts, some of them I have not even spoken to, but they will attest to the fact that the Birmingham Police Department is lying to the general public.
So are you saying if he in fact allegedly hit a police officer, you're saying assault should be included in the list?
I'm saying that would have been included. You can rest assured of that, ma'am. And it wasn't. And I will say this. The first question I asked the city attorney yesterday, before we started going through any footage, because I didn't want to miss it, I said, I want you to show me anywhere on any of these number of body cam, this body cam footage, where my client struck or attempted to strike a Birmingham police officer. I not asked once, I not asked twice, multiple times. At no point could he show me. To the point he said, I'll be honest, I haven't even watched all of the footage. And I said, but your officers released the footage that had been edited for public consumption.
Mr. Benz, if you're reinstated and have to go back to the band, will you feel safe, because you know you're gonna run into it, will you feel safe stadium with Birmingham police?
That's a tough question. I would definitely, and this is something I heard, I would definitely not shy away from doing the performance, because at the end of the day, it's about the kids. And so if the kids want to do a performance that would cause us to have to interact with the Birmingham police, we request that we would have additional SROs on site for us. But I will do whatever is needed, which is best for our students. And so if we're going there to do a performance, we're gonna go have a performance.
In the video footage,
let me do this. She's been had her hand up. I'm sorry.
Yeah, Jillian Brooks, WDRC. A question kind of going back to the lights. Do you know if there was any school administration present from either district?
We have not been able to get that answer. I spoke with Dr. Sullivan today. And he's going to get back with me on that. He's checking himself. He intimated that he thought there was. The only thing about that intimation, he mentioned the principal that was there the year before, and they're no longer at the school.
So, from our understanding, Birmingham police officers approached both band directors. Since you've seen the video, would you be able to share what you witnessed, if there was any differences in the way officers approached them, maybe the same way or differently?
I think that the way that they approached my client, that he was treated, because A, in one of the pieces of footage, you'll hear the J.O. Bang saying, go home, go home, go home. Let's be mindful of the fact this was Jackson Olin's homecoming. This was a really big week. They have one of the largest homecoming and homecoming weeks in the city of Birmingham. I believe tempers flared because of the score, number one. They were the home team, and it's homecoming, and they lost. So I think there were many different factors. And of course, they're working for the Birmingham City School System. They weren't working for Jefferson County. So if there are no further questions, we want to thank each of you for coming out today. Hopefully we were able to shed some light or some different perspectives on this ongoing situation, and hopefully we will bring this situation to an end. We are asking the City of Birmingham to drop all charges against Mr. Mims and to make him whole again, as whole as possible, and we will keep you all up to date with any further details regarding this particular matter. Thank you.